Welcome to the NASA High Power Rocketry video series. In this video, we'll discuss the propulsion systems in high power rocketry. To start, let's discuss and define some propulsion terminology. Propulsion means moving forward or onward. Therefore, a propulsion system provides a force that moves a body of matter. Rocket propulsion is a type of propulsion that produces forces by ejecting stored matter called propellant. In high-power rocketry, we use chemical rocket propulsion. In chemical rocket propulsion, high-pressure combustion reactions of the propellants creates high-temperature gases that are ejected out of the vehicle. The combustion chamber is where the chemical reactions take place. The gases are compressed in the converging section of the nozzle and reach the speed of sound at the throat of the nozzle. Then they expand and accelerate to supersonic speeds in the diverging section of the nozzle. When they reach the nozzle exit, they are expelled into the atmosphere. This expulsion of mass creates a force that we call the thrust of the rocket. Thrust is the force that acts on the vehicle to make it move and is generated by the rocket propulsion system. When thrust is generated in one direction, it creates movement in the opposite direction. This is defined by Newton's third law of motion. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Therefore, the thrust created by the motor causes the vehicle to move in the opposite direction. Mathematically, the thrust force, F, can be calculated by examining the change of momentum of the expelled gases, the pressure of the gases at the exit nozzle, the ambient pressure outside of the nozzle, and the area of the nozzle exit, where dm over dt is the change in mass per unit time of the rocket propellant in the system as the propellant is expelled through the nozzle. V sub 2 is the velocity of the gas as it exits the nozzle. P sub 2 is the pressure at the nozzle exit. P sub 3 is the local ambient pressure outside of the propulsion system. And A sub 2 is the nozzle exit area. Generally, the thrust of a rocket motor is not constant and changes over the course of the burn. Most hobby rocket motors start with a higher thrust and gradually taper off over the course of the burning time. Motor manufacturers provide a thrust curve or a graph that plots thrust versus the burn time so that you can see how the thrust varies during the burn. The total impulse is the total energy released by the propellant in a propulsion system. Mathematically, it is the thrust of the rocket motor integrated over the burning time, where I sub t is the total impulse, F is the thrust, and t is the burning time. If you make the assumption that the thrust is constant, you can simplify the equation and multiply the constant thrust by the burn time. This is a handy tool when you are not familiar with the entire burn profile of a motor and just want to use the average thrust. The specific impulse is the total impulse per unit weight of propellant, and it is an important concept for the performance of a propulsion system. An easy comparison is the specific impulse of a rocket propulsion system to the miles per gallon of a car. A higher number means the propulsion system is doing more work and giving off more energy for the amount of propellant it contains. If you want an efficient motor, you should use one with a very high specific impulse. The specific impulse is calculated by dividing the total impulse by the mass flow rate, or the amount of mass expelled per unit time. Integrated over time, where I sub s is the specific impulse, g sub 0 is the acceleration due to gravity, m dot is the mass flow rate, and t is time. If you assume there is constant thrust and mass flow rate, and m sub p is the total propellant mass, then the equation can be simplified to dividing the thrust multiplied by the burn time divided by the propellant mass multiplied by the acceleration due to gravity. Now that you understand some key terms of propulsion systems, let's talk about motor designation. Rocketry motors are designated by their total impulse, average thrust, and sometimes the delay time between motor burnout and the ejection charge. A few manufacturers provide the exact total impulse in the motor designation. The motor designation will have a minimum of two elements, a letter and a number. The letter corresponds to a range of total impulse with units of Newton seconds. The total impulse ranges for high power rocketry start at H and goes to O. H corresponds to a total impulse range of 160 and 01 Newton seconds to 320 Newton seconds. I corresponds to a total impulse range of 320.01 Newton seconds to 640 Newton seconds. Notice that the total impulse range of each letter is twice as high as the previous letter. The letter only gives a range. It does not give the exact total impulse of that motor. So, a motor with 325 Newton seconds of total impulse and a motor of 620 Newton seconds of total impulse are both I motors, even though one motor has nearly double the total impulse of the other. The number corresponds to the average thrust of the motor in Newtons. For example, if the number is 500, the average thrust for that motor is 500 Newtons. Some manufacturers give the exact total impulse in addition to the normal letter that corresponds to the range of total impulse. In the configuration, the total impulse is given before the letter. In this example, 2406 is the total impulse for this motor in Newton seconds. The K is the total impulse range between 1280 Newton seconds and 2560 Newton seconds. And 555 is the average thrust of the motor in Newtons. Some smaller rocket motors have a number at the end of the designation that is separated by a dash. This number corresponds to the time between motor burnout and when the ejection charge is ignited. The dash 14 after H123 denotes a 14-second delay between the motor burnout and the ejection charge ignition. There are two common types of motors used in high-power rocketry: solid motors and hybrid motors. Solid motors are more common and consist of a propellant in a solid physical state. Solid propellants are a combination of fuel and oxidizer with a binder to hold them together in a homogeneous mixture. The propellant itself is divided into sections called grains. The geometry of the grain can vary depending on the intended burn characteristics. The grains are housed inside a liner, which provides a thermal barrier between the burning propellant and the metal case. The liner then slides inside an aluminum case. A nozzle is placed at one end, and a set of closures complete the motor assembly. O-rings usually accompany the closures to ensure a good seal. Some motors have an ejection charge at the top of the motor, which automatically fires the charge at certain times after the burn is complete. Generally, the aluminum motor case and closures are reusable, but the propellant grains, the liner, nozzle, and O-rings are consumable for each launch. Motor assembly varies for each manufacturer, and those details must be taught by an experienced high-power rocketry mentor. The other common, yet less used, type of motor is the hybrid motor. Hybrid motors use a combination of propellants in different chemical states. The fuel is usually a solid, where the oxidizer is usually a gas. The oxidizer is stored in a separate tank that is typically above the section of the motor that stores the solid fuel. Each manufacturer of hybrid motors arranges the propellants in a slightly different configuration. Hybrid motors are fun and interesting, but require more ground support equipment. The topics of propulsion and rocket motors provide opportunities to discuss several key scientific and mathematical principles. The most significant would be Newton's laws of motion. To review, they are: an object at rest will stay at rest, and an object in motion will stay in motion, unless a net force acts on the object. This law applies to rocketry throughout the entire flight, from resting on the launch pad to landing on the ground. As the rocket sits on the pad, there is no net force acting on the rocket. There are forces acting on the rocket, but they are equal. The force of gravity is pulling the rocket down, and the force normal, or the force applied to the rocket by the launch pad, is pushing up on the rocket. Once the count gets to zero and the launch button is pushed, things change. Once the motor is ignited, a chemical reaction takes place and the hot gases are expelled out of the nozzle of the rocket. This is where Newton's third law comes into play. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. This law deals with the balancing of forces. The hot gases being expelled by the motor exert a certain amount of force on the air outside the rocket. The air exerts a force equal and directly opposite to that force on the rocket. This force is equal in magnitude to the motor's force and causes the rocket to move in the opposite direction of the motor's force. We can use Newton's second law to determine how fast the rocket moves due to this force. As we learned in this segment, the average force of a rocket motor is measured by the motor manufacturer and included in the designation of the motor. For instance, a K1050 motor has an average thrust of 1050 newtons. The weight of the rocket is its weight in kilograms, with the motor inserted and ready to fly. Dividing the force by the weight gives us the initial acceleration of the rocket in meters per second per second, or it's more commonly called meters per second squared. The key concept of Newton's second law is that the heavier the rocket, the more slowly it will accelerate. The lighter the rocket, the more quickly it will accelerate, which could result in a higher flight if everything else is identical. The rocket will continue to accelerate as long as the motor is burning and the thrust of the rocket is greater than the force of gravity. This part of the flight is called powered ascent. Once the motor burns out, then the force of gravity is greater than the thrust, which is now zero, and the rocket begins to slow down. During this part of the flight, the rocket is still going higher, but its velocity is quickly diminishing. At some point, the velocity will become zero for an instant, and the rocket will stop gaining altitude. This point is called apogee. After this brief instant, the rocket will begin to descend. The force of gravity will continue to accelerate the rocket at a rate of 9.81 meters per second squared until one of two things happens. Either a parachute is deployed or the rocket hits the ground. As you can imagine, in the second scenario, the rocket will hit the ground with an incredible amount of speed and energy. This is called a ballistic landing, and it's very dangerous. The possibility of a ballistic landing is just one of the reasons that safety procedures must be carefully followed. In a successful rocket launch, the parachute is deployed and slows the rocket. The deployed parachute provides another type of force called drag. Drag is in the direction opposite the movement of the rocket. Gravity is pulling the rocket back to the Earth, but drag is slowing that fall. Generally, the larger the parachute, the greater the drag, and the greater the drag, the slower the rocket will descend. Overall, rocketry is an excellent example of Newton's laws of motion. Employing a model rocket or even a high-power launch, if possible, will enthrall your students and open up discussion about these very important concepts. Thank you for watching the NASA High Power Rocketry video series.